friend Matt Zimmerman on the way to Gainesville with the football broadcast team right now. I'm sure he'd love to be at Bud Walton Arena tonight for the red-white game. And Z, we bring you in here. We had that little segment rejoin is titled Angry Coaches. I think you heard it when they put you on hold. Do you have a coach that you've either coached with or coached against, or just games you watched on television that you were entertained by when they would get worked up? Who would be at the top of the list of a coach that got worked up that was entertaining for you?
Well, I like to watch Coach Musselman. You know, only got to see that for a year. He was pretty entertaining last year, and especially when in the games when we would be sitting right by the bench, because he'd get pretty animated and get going pretty good sometimes. So I enjoyed that. And then as a high school coach, there were several coaches, you know, that you knew when they kind of made it to the point where they were boiling and they were really upset, or they would just have other ways that they express themselves, laughing or doing stuff, or you know, other type of shenanigans on the bench. Coaches are very, very creative, and everyone handles the stress of the games and their teams different ways. So there's some good ones. I know when I was I loved Tom Penders when I was with the Razorbacks and watching him, the old Texas Longhorn coach. And actually, one time when we played him, he was at Houston, and we were at UAB, and it was a sold-out 8,000 people in Bartow Arena at UAB, and we were beating them, and he had a heart attack, and during the right before halftime, and he was going nuts on the officials, and so he went down, and we all were just scared to death. We thought he was having a heart attack, and they put him on a gurney, took him out of there. The 8,000 people gave him a standing ovation, and we were worried sick, and at halftime, we went to check on him. I was working with Mike Anderson at the time. We went to check on him outside his locker room. He was sitting up on the gurney, and he was drinking him a Diet Coke. And he said, "I'm feeling a lot better." And start the second half, you know where Tom Penders was? He was coaching on that. He was sitting there coaching. He was coaching his team. He didn't miss a minute. And I'm not saying he faked a heart attack, because I'm not sure what was going on inside his body. But I know he did not want that technical foul. And so maybe he thought he could, you know, use that. I'm not sure. I don't know. But it was not a big national TV game or nothing, so it didn't get a lot of national play. There was national play that he'd had a heart attack, but he was fine. He coached the second half, didn't miss a game the rest of the year. He was always a character, Tom Penders.
You know, I always see with, like, when you know Mike Neighbors is upset when the jacket comes off. You could always tell that with Coach A, too. I wonder, right, for you, when you're on the broadcast, is there a tell with Muss that you can tell, like, all right, he's had enough now? Is it an extra Diet Pepsi sip? Is it a pound of the chicken? Because he doesn't wear the jacket, so I don't know where to look.
Now, usually it's the slapping of the scores table. He'll hit the scores table real hard. And when he does that, you know he's getting pretty wound up. I've seen him do that and then kind of regroup and not be upset. But I've also seen him do that, and then he just keeps escalating. And, you know, he had those little technical fouls there early on last year, and then he kind of got settled in, and he didn't really have any problems with it after that. And so, you know, he's pretty good. I think he lets the referees do their thing, but then there's times he'll get to boil and he'll get really frustrated. And I would say most of the time he gets frustrated more with the team than he does the officials, but he will get mad at an official as well. And it's always entertaining. It is definitely entertaining. And then, you know, every coach does things different ways. Like Coach Nolan Richardson, you know, he would yell. He had a booming voice, very, very loud. And, you know, you knew when he was upset just from his voice. He wasn't hitting stuff. He wasn't stomping around. He was just loud, and his voice would grow louder and louder as he was more upset. And every coach has their own ways of dealing with that.
Z, I think going into the last 2 years, you kind of knew who your top scorers would be. I'm not too sure if I know who that will be on this year's basketball team. And I wonder who you would expect to be, you know. I mean, there are going to be more than one go-to guy, but if this team would need a bucket, who's the player that you think?
I'm on the bus. We're in the middle of the Boston Mountains. I hear you. I mean, I can't really hear you. I think you said who the go-to guy would be.
That's right. I want to know who you think could be the lead scorer on this second year of Eric Musselman's Arkansas tenure. Yeah, I kind of knew this might happen. I mean, when the bus leaves at 12 o'clock and it's heading on I-49 and it's 12:36.
Run into that signal.
South, that's right.
Yeah, we lost him.
They're running right through the Boston Mountains, and I think we all understand what that's like. Good luck having a regular phone conversation if you're ever driving on the bridges on the interstate. So we'll give Z another call and try to get him back on here. But, you know, and I don't really know where to look here. I mean, I think there might be three guys that you look to potentially be leading scorers on this team. We've heard a lot about JT Note, transfer to sit out after 1 year after coming over from Jacksonville. I think Jalen Tate, the grad transfer out of Northern Kentucky, those could be options for your top scorer. And then Moses Moody, I think, is the guy that all of us expect to be the most explosive of the scorers. But as a freshman, as a true freshman, who really can know? So we got Z back here on the bus.
He said they're going through the Boston Mountains, so you may need to talk louder.
I'll open the window and scream out the window if that'll help you, Z. So who do you think could be the leading scorer on this team for Eric Musselman?
Who will be the leading scorer?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, who's your guess?
I don't know. I mean, it could be Vance Jackson. It could be Justin Smith. But I think at the end of the day, it very well will be Moses Moody. He's so smooth and fluid. I mean, I love watching him in practice. He's so fundamentally sound. He's got a really good demeanor as a freshman. I think he's going to be a guy that comes in as a freshman, and he does what Isaiah did as a freshman, average 15, 16 points a game. And he might even get more than that. He's a really, really good offensive player.
Matt Zimmerman here with us on Halftime. Z, when you kind of look at the makeup of this team, and I was mentioning it before we got you on here, this team is going to look like a complete opposite from what we last saw in March as far as with more height, more length. I think you got more shooters on this team. But if you're a fan and you tune in tonight for this red-white game, where do you think fans will see the biggest difference from last year's team heading into this year's team?
Well, they're going to be a lot bigger, more athletic, and a lot more weapons. I mean, he could play 11 guys, and there's a lot of guys that he can turn to. You know, last year he was playing 7/8 guys, and I don't, you know, his MO throughout his 5 years as a head coach in college basketball has been to play 7 or 8. But he's going to be able to play 11 guys. He's going to have much more depth, and there's not very many teams in the SEC that will have the depth that he's going to have at his disposal.
One of the things I'm really looking forward to seeing with this red-white game tonight, and I don't know how much stock you can take from it, but I'm anxious to see how Coach Musselman and this coaching staff works in Connor Vanover into this team, because it's a unique athlete. It's a new unique player, being 7'3", being able to stretch the floor that he will, and being able to shoot the three ball. How do you see Musselman and this crew being able to work in Connor Vanover into the fold?
Well, that's a good question. I think he's going to be a good piece to this team. I do think he's a piece. You know, I don't think he's going to lead this team in scoring or anything, but he can shoot the ball so well, and he is so darn big that he is a very, very positive offensive player. And he can kind of affect the game a little bit. Defense, he's not the fastest of foot. He doesn't move side to side that great, but he's so long, he can make up for errors with his length. He's been, I'm not sure, maybe a little bit under the weather. I'm not sure. Just hearing him talk, maybe he's been, you know, maybe he's missed a practice or two or three. And so, you know, I don't know about tonight, but I know I went through there the other day, was practicing, and it's the same old Connor. He gets open, he squares his shoulders up, takes his time, he's going to make it. I mean, he can really shoot the basketball. This guy's 7'3". That's a pretty nice weapon to have in your back pocket.
Z, you guys are heading down to Gainesville right quick. I just want to get your thoughts real quick on this football matchup, and not necessarily from an X's and O perspective, but just – there's a lot of emotion heading into this ballgame. I mean, with Sam Pittman not making the trip down there, you got Barry Odom coaching. How do you expect this team to come out of the gate against Florida this week from like an emotional standpoint, being laser focused in this ballgame?
Well, man, I think that they're going to play super hard. They've been doing that all year. They're going to be very motivated to play for Coach Pittman. I know a lot of media has speculated that, and that'll be the case. These guys are playing right now. They're having fun, and that's the best thing a team can be. They can, when they're confident and having fun and enjoy being around each other, they're going to have a great game. And I think the Hogs will play very, very well on Saturday. Sounds like Florida's got a couple guys banged up. And, you know, Florida's coming off of a high, an extreme high against Georgia. Beating Tennessee is a big deal, but it's not quite the same as beating Georgia. You know, and that rivalry's so big, maybe they'll have a little bit of a dip Saturday. And I think it's going to be awesome. The biggest problem right now is, you know, on this bus that we're on, it's a beautiful bus and it's been great. This is our fourth trip, but today's Masters Thursday, and the TVs aren't working. So we're in a little bit of a pickle here. You know, and we've got about 16 hours ahead of us, Matt, Phil, and that's 32 hours total this weekend on this bus. As much as I like Geno Bell and Clint Grovey, I'd really like to be able to look at the Masters on TV. You know what I mean?
Now, Z, I mean, I've been on some 16-hour bus rides in minor league baseball, and that was before the advent of everybody having a phone that could play movies for them. So I tell you what, I feel for you, my friend. Get in some sleep as much as you possibly can. That's the best way to make bus rides go fast.
Hey, last thing before we... baseball life, you know the deal.
Yeah, that's true. Last thing before we let you go, JT texted, and he wants to know if you think that this year's basketball team could press more than we've seen in recent years.
Well, absolutely. Well, not back years. I mean, compared to last year, they will. Now, they're not going to press as much as, you know, the year before that when Mike Anderson was here as a pressing coach, you know. So, but when they did press last year, those were still a lot of the same players, so they knew how to press. They were pretty good at it. And I think Coach Musselman, although he's not considered a pressing coach, don't be surprised. That's a good question, because I think with the depth that he has, he'll be able to really press people and get after them. Especially in this non-conference slate, you know, we've got about seven home non-conference games. Like some people call them bye games or whatever. And against those guys, those kind of teams, you'll be able to press them and probably be able to beat them. You know, just off athletic ability, full court, up tempo, getting after them. Pressing is a great neutralizer when you have more talent. It really helps you. And that's a good question. I don't know how much Coach will press. But I would not be surprised to see him press quite a bit with this team because he's got 11 guys.
See, we'll leave it there. Appreciate the time, man.
Thanks,
especially
Z.
On the bus.
I'm sorry I sat out on you. It's just right here, a bad time in the mountains. But enjoy being on with you guys. Hope you can hear me okay.
No, we heard you fine. It happens. It's all right. It's living in Arkansas.
Guys.
We all understand
all right.
That.
Thanks,
okay,
Z.
You got
right,
it. Matt Zimmerman on the way to Gainesville.